God bless you all this morning. Ready to enter into his presence this morning. Amen. Glad that you are all here with us this morning, because each one of you bring a little bit of him with you. And where there's a lot of little bits, there's ends up being a whole lot. Amen. Now life gets kind of busy, so we look forward to being in his presence. Amen. So let us all stand, and we will ask the Lord to join us with prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we are indeed grateful to be your children this morning, Father. Lord, we look forward to what you would have for us this morning, Father. We come hungry, Lord, and looking to be in your presence this morning, Father. And Lord, for those that need a reaffirm, Lord, or a touch, Lord, as humans, Lord, we get used to being around you, Father. And Lord, we don't ever want to get dull or insensitive to where you are, Father, and where your presence is. So, Lord, this morning I pray, Lord, that for each person that's here this morning and those that may be watching, that you would be our portion this morning, Lord, that your presence may be truly felt, Lord, and that you would just affirm, Lord, to us there that we are here with you and that you're here with us, Father. Lord, we do appreciate your word, Lord, and what you have done for us this week. And, Lord, we look forward to what you will do for us. And we just thank you in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. You can be seated. Number 612 in your Only Believe book, As the Deer Panteth for the Water. As the deer panteth for the water, so my soul longeth after thee. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee. For you alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone does my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee. You are my friend and you are my brother, even though you are my king. I want you more than any other, so much more than anything. For you alone are my strength, my shield. Alone does my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee. I want you more than gold or silver, only you can satisfy. You alone are the real joy giver and the apple of my eye. For you alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone does my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee. Amen. That is our desire this morning, is just to worship him. Amen. Number 266, Because he lives. God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, oh, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone, because I know He holds the future, and life is worth the living just because He lives. And then one day I'll cross that river, I'll fight life's fight, no war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory and I'll know He reigns. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds the future, and life is worth the living just because He lives. Amen. Are you thankful He lives? Most of all, we know where He lives. Amen. At this time, we're going to take our prayer request before the Lord. Does anyone have one they'd like to make known before I go through the list? Amen. We did have quite a few come in on the emails. Brother Victor Akawaru, his mother, he's a pastor, his mother is in the hospital. She was had malaria, and then it led to some other complications. So remember his mom in prayer. Brother Mark Bailey's daughter is 5 months along, I believe, or something like that, and she's in the hospital with preeclampsia. So remember her in prayer that God would help them with their pregnancy. Also, Sister Becky and Brother Nate's third little boy got here, and everything's good. Yeah, his name is Solomon. He's going to be the SS, right? Super sport. Solomon Shear, amen. Very healthy little guy, and Adelaide and them got a new brother, amen. Also, Zoe and her husband will be traveling back this morning and ask for prayer. She'd come up with a migraine and stuff, so pray with them that they would have a safe journey home. Also continuing, Brother Bill Caldwell in Oregon, Brother Brian Chips for his continued healing, also for Brother John McRae and the church, and then also for Brother Arthur's son who's in the hospital with a coma, and Brother Samson Labugo for continued healing. Helena and Michael are in Poland, so remember them in prayer. Brother Bob Keir in Australia asked for prayer. Brother Mark and Beth, that was also this request as well, in South Africa. And then also for our brothers and sisters around the world and the churches that are gathering to worship this morning. And then also for Brother Webster in Malawi and Brother Samuel Otegit. I can't remember which brother was just traveling, but he had a very good ministers meeting overseas, and a lot of good things come out of that. So I want to thank the Lord. All our unspoken prayer requests this morning can be known by an uplifted hand, and we'll go to the Lord with prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we humbly come before You this morning, Lord, with confidence of Your word, Lord, that You've given to us, Father. And so, Lord, we want to ask You for these requests that we've mentioned before You this morning. Lord, for those that are needing healing in their body, Lord, we just ask that You would visit them this morning and continue the healing that You've already given them, Father. So, Lord, we ask also for those that are traveling, Father, Brother Michael, Sister Peter, the Guziks, Father, over in Poland. Father, may they be a blessing to the brothers and sisters while they're there, Father, and may their fellowship, Lord, start and spark a, a new revival, Father, Lord, for and a thirst for your word, Father, and Lord, for those others that are traveling this morning, Father, may you just be with them. And Lord, for Sister Becky and Brother Nate this morning, Lord, we pray, Lord, that you would be with them. Lord, help Sister Becky to recover. And Lord, may you be with their new son, Father. Lord, we pray, Lord, that you're in all things, Lord, for all of our families, Father. And we do thank you for the protection that you give to us every day, Father, and the health that you give to us. And Lord, because we know everything comes from you, Father. And so, Lord, we just pray for all these requests, Lord, and those hands that were lifted this morning, Lord, we don't lift them up to you just, Lord, for a show of hands. Lord, we do have desires upon our hearts, Lord, and those of us that just want to draw closer to you, and Lord, those that have loved ones, Lord, that we pray for, Lord, we want to see them saved, Father, and in the ship with us, Father, as we cross over, Lord, when you would call for us. We thank you, Lord, for all these things in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Brother Steve and Brother Steve, if you would come, we'll take up our tithe and offering this morning. Amen. Brother Steve Patton, if you'd ask the Lord's blessing this morning. While they're taking that up, you guys can turn in your only believe book to number 77, and we'll get ready to turn our eyes upon Jesus. Oh, soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior, and life more abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face. And the things of this earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Through death into life everlasting, he passed and we follow him there. Over us sin hath no more dominion, for more than conquerors we are. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of this earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. His word shall not fail you, he promised. Believe him and all will be well. Then go to a world that is dying, his perfect salvation to tell. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of this earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Amen. We want to be in his light this morning. Amen. God bless you now. Let us all stand and we'd sing Only Believe as we ask Bill Ryan to come.
only believe, only believe, all things are possible, only believe, only believe. Things are possible, only believe. Jesus, you're here. Jesus, you're here. All things are possible now that you're here. Jesus, you're here. All things are possible now that you're here. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Dear gracious Father, we are so happy, O God, to know that you're here. And believing, Father, you have not left us nor forsaken us, but you've come down in this hour to do something, Lord, that you've never done before. Your great parousia presence, you've come with a message, O God. And not just to a prophet, but Father, through the lips of that prophet, you've spoken that to a generation of believers, a generation of your children that you are transforming by the renewing of our mind. And Father, we just pray that we would get out of the way, just let go and let God, and let the Holy Spirit that is within us by predestination, by a new birth, that it might begin to project the very message itself, the very message which is Christ. Christ in us, the hope of glory. Be with us, Father, as we step aside from ourselves and we ask you, Lord, to take charge of this service. In the precious name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. You may be seated. I greet you all in the precious name, the most lovely name of our Lord Jesus Christ. This morning we're going to look at number 40 in our series, and we're calling it God's frequency, the frequency of his word. And from the sermon, Man That Can Turn on the Light, Brother Branham said, now the seed was already upon the earth. I believe God had planted that seed, and remember we talked about that seed has been circling the earth for the last 2,000 years, and actually more than that, because we go back to the book of Isaiah and the different Bible, the different things that were said throughout the scriptures, and they're there. Brother Justin, there's a brother who wants to get in. He's outside. I believe he's from Congo. Another brother from Congo. Anyway, Brother Bram says that now the seed was already upon the earth. I believe God had planted the seed, and just as long as the sun could get to that seed, it began to grow. And that's the reason it only takes days to bring forth these things, because the seed was already in the earth. All it needed was light. Now, I'd like to just take this to Scripture, because this is a very important thing. Brother Branham is saying that the seed was already the earth. And so we're going to look at it from Genesis 1. And we're going to see that God placed his seed by his own word. He placed his word seed in the earth. So when the Logos went forth, it was not a physical seed at this point, but a spoken word seed. In other words, when God said, let there be horse, there was a spirit horse. When God said, let there be apple tree, that was spirit apple tree, or logos apple tree. That is what Brother Brown meant when he said every seed was in the earth, because God placed it there by the spoken word, as we see in Genesis chapter 1. Now, Brother Vail, years and years ago, I was like 29 years old when I first started pastoring, and he gave me his notes from his sermon called The Logos. And in The Logos, Brother Vail, he used to write his sermons out longhand, so he'd have maybe 8, 10, 12 pages longhand, and he'd go through that. And in this, he was talking about, he said these very same words. He said, when God said, let there be horse, he said there was spirit horse. In other words, animals have spirits. They don't have soul, but they have spirits, okay? And so you had spirit horse. And so what we're looking at is when God speaks, that is a life that brings forth. All right, now you look at a seed, the endoderm, the exoderm, they're not the seed, okay? They're just protect the seed. The seed is actually the life, the invisible life that lays within the seed itself. Now, we read in Genesis 1, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. Now, as Brother Branham taught us, there could have been a million billion years from when God created the heavens and the earth to when it actually came forth in its physical form. Why? Because God created all things by his word. And before it was a word, it was a thought in his mind. Then, when that thought was expressed, it became spoken word. Now, most men are ignorant of this fact that God created all things by his word. He thought it first, then he spoke it, and then later he clothed it with the physical elements that make up the earth. We're going to go through chapter 1 and 2 just to show you this is exactly what the scripture tells us. All right? Peter even tells us this in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 5. He says, "For this they willingly are ignorant of, that by the word of God the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of the water and in the water." In other words, God spoke it, and it came into existence. He says, by the word of God, the heavens were of old. Well, what do you mean the heavens were of old? They were created. They were there because God spoke it. It's God's spoken word. Now, we read in the book of Isaiah, chapter 40, verse 26, "Lift up your eyes on high, and behold, who hath created these things? That bringeth out their host by number. He calleth them by all by names, by the greatness of his might, for that he is strong in power, not one that faileth." So we see that it is God that created all these things. Then in the book of Revelation, chapter 4, verse 11, we read, "Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are all created." Again in Colossians 1 and 16, the Apostle Paul said, "For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible." So see, the invisible was the spoken word. Those things that were created, also angels and things like that. "Whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by him and for him." And finally, we see that God used his firstborn son, Jesus Christ, to create all things. God is a creator, but he used his son to bring forth. In Ephesians 3 and 9, it says, "To make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ." So he was Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Logos that went out of God. He was the instrument by which God created. Had God not done anything, the creation would have still been there because it's in the thoughts of God. All right, it was just as good as done. But it wouldn't have been acted upon or manifested until that word spoke. So let's go back to chapter 1 and verse 2. "And the earth was without form, and it was void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep." Now, if something is without form, then what is it? It doesn't have form, right? Is it a mist? No, a mist still has form. It's nothing. It was without form, and it was void. What's a void? A void's an absence of anything. Now, remember, we already read in verse 1 that God created the heavens and the earth, yet here we are told the earth was without form. And if it is without form, as the scripture declares, then it is still in spirit form, or thought form. In the mind of God, it was created at this point. But it had not yet, at this point, taken on a physical form to make it a visible entity. Let's read again. "And the earth was without form and void." And the Hebrew word for form is tohu, and it means an empty place, without form, nothing. Some translations actually say the earth was nothing at this point. It was a nothing. You know, they say today they use a nothing burger. I guess you got a bun and you got nothing in between. Well, that's what the earth was. It was a nothing burger. It was just not there physically. All right? And then Moses adds, "The earth was without form and void." And this word void was translated from the Hebrew word bohu. So you have tohu and bohu, which means vacuity or vacuity, which means emptiness. And this word vacuity means a state of being vacuous or without contents. Vacancy, emptiness, nothing there. So you see, when God made the heavens and the earth, it was at this point still in the mind of God. There was no substance at this point. It was empty and without any shape or form. And then God began to move upon what he had spoken or what he had thought, and he began to speak, as we read in the second half of verse, "And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters." And now notice verse 3, "And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw the light that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness, and God called the light day, and the darkness he called night, and the evening and the morning were the first day." Now everybody reads this and they say, "Oh, that's the sun," S-U-N. No, it's not the sun. Verse 14 tells you when God created the sun. So God created this light, he calls it day, and that light divided the light from darkness. God calls it day. Now, at this point, God has not yet brought forth anything into a created form as yet. And I want you to notice in verse 3, this is the first time we see that God speaks. And when he speaks, this light comes forth, and he calls that light day. Now, I believe, according to the vindicated prophet, that this light was resulted from the very first time God speaks. I believe it is the spoken word logos that went out of God, which is the Son of God. From his sermon, Questions and Answers on Genesis, Brother Branham said, now, notice then, after a while, I begin to see a little light, a sacred light. What's sacred mean? Sanctified, right? A little sacred light, sanctified light, begins to form. Like a little halo or something. You could only see it by spiritual eyes to look now. You could only see it by spiritual eyes, okay? Not these physical things that we have. It's a different dimension. While we're looking, the whole church now, we're standing on the great big banister watching what God's doing, and we'll get right down to this question here, and you'll see how he brings it out. Now, no one has seen God, and now the next thing that we see by eyes of supernatural looking, we see a little white light forming out there. What is it? What is that? That was called by the Bible readers Logos, or the anointed, or the anointing. Or as I was going to say, the part of God began to develop into something so human beings could have some type of an idea what it was. Now, this is way before human beings were even brought forth. You see, God's always looking down the road. You know, because he sets his plan forth. The part of God began to develop into something so human beings could have some type of an idea what it was. It was a little light moving. That was the word of God. Now, God gave himself birth to the Son, which was before there was even an Adam in the air, or air to make an Adam. That was, see, Jesus said, glorify me, Father, with the glory we had before the foundation of the world. See, way back yonder. Now, I'm continuing with question and answers on Genesis, paragraph 26, Brother Branham says, now, no man has seen the Father at any time. No man can see God in the bodily form, because God is not in body form. Whoa. What do you do with all those people that believe that Jesus is God or one like your fingers one? God is not in body form. God is a spirit. See? All right. No man has seen the Father, but the only begotten of the Father hath declared him. 1 John. See? Now, but notice now, there's nothing. There's just space. There's no light. There's no dark. There's no nothing. It just seems nothing. So again, Brother Bram is confirming what the Hebrew says. It was nothing. There was nothing there. But there is a great supernatural being, Jehovah God. And now in paragraph 28 says, but notice, then after a while I begin to see a little light, a little sacred light begin to form like a little halo or something. You could only see it by the spiritual eyes to look now. While we're looking, the whole church now, we're standing on God's great big banister watching what God's doing, and we'll get right down to the question here, and you'll see how he brings it in. Now, no one has seen God, and now the next thing we begin to see by eyes of supernatural looking, we see a little white light forming out there. What is that? That was called by Bible readers Logos, or anointed, or the anointing, or as I was going to say, that part of God began to develop into something so human beings could have some type of an idea what it was. It was a little light moving. That was the word of God. Now, God gave himself birth to this Son, which was before there was even an Adam made, or heir to make the Adam. See, Jesus said, glorify me, Father, with the glory I had before the foundation of the world. Now, before we go any further, and I just read this a couple times because I want to emphasize, before we go any further, let me say that the people, they read this wrong. People in this message, people outside of the message don't read what Brother Branham says, okay? Unless they're doing it to criticize. But people in this message read this wrong. They are reading what Brother Branham is saying here with a pre-filter that reads, God gave birth to himself. Now, how could God, who's already existing, give birth to himself? As I said overseas, I said, you know, I remember years ago watching a Bugs Bunny cartoon. And the Bugs Bunny cartoon, he was a magician. He had on this tall hat. And there, he pulls out some ears out of the hat. Well, then he pulls himself through the hat. All right? In other words, how could God give birth to himself when he already exists? All right? It doesn't even make sense. He said, God gave himself. He didn't say God gave birth to himself. He said God gave himself. What did he give himself? He gave birth to this Son, to his Son. That is totally different than giving himself birth. To read it as God giving himself birth does not even make sense. seeing he already existed. But to give himself a son by birthing that son forth into existence is altogether different. Now, there becomes two involved, one who is God and one who is not God. And I could take and show you, I mean, we don't have time to do it, but I could show you, of course, Brother Brown says, when that Logos came forth, says, now we have two now. Out of the Father came the Son. All right? Now, Brother Brown basically says the same thing in several other sermons, so we're just going to read those in just a minute. So we see that when God gave himself gave birth to himself a son, it was a part of God coming forth, the very life of God coming into his son. When a father impregnates his wife, okay, a part of the father is there to give birth to that child. You understand? All right, when you look at your children, you see yourself, parts of yourself in that child. And so we see very plainly written in the book, Proverbs 8, 22 to 36. I'm going to read from the NIV. It says, the Lord brought me forth as the first of his works. See that? Genesis 1, 3. Before his deeds of old. I was appointed from eternity, from the beginning. Remember, go back to Revelation chapter 7. He was the lamb that was slain before the foundations of the world. Okay? I was appointed from eternity, from the beginning, before the world began. When there were no oceans, I was given birth. When there were no springs abounding with water, before the mountains were settled in place, before the hills, I was given birth. Before he made the earth or its fields or any of the dust of the world, I was there when he set the heavens in place. When he marked out the horizon on the face of the deep, when he established the clouds above and fixed securely the fountains of the deep, when he gave the sea its boundary so the waters would not overstep his command, and when he marked out the foundations of the earth, then I was a craftsman at his sight. I was filled with delight day after day, rejoicing always in his presence, rejoicing in his whole world, and delighting in mankind. Now then, my son, listen to me. Blessed are those who keep my ways. Listen to my instruction and be wise. Do not be ignorant. Blessed is the man who listens to me, watching daily at my doors, waiting at my doorway. For whosoever finds me finds life. Isn't that what Jesus said? And receives favor from the Lord. But whosoever fails to find me harms himself. All who hate me love death. Now Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And doesn't John tell us, he that hath the Son hath life? Well, now what's more importantly is that the word hath is a Greek word echo. He that echoes the Son echoes life. Why? Because it's the same God life that's in you saying the same thing. Now remember, Jesus himself said, the Son can do nothing but what the Father shows him to do. He also said the Son can say nothing but what the Father commands him to say. So Jesus then, in the beginning, before the foundations of the world, when he came forth as a son, a logos, when he was birthed by the spoken word of God, he could only do in creation what God had him to do. The Father worketh, the Son worketh hitherto. Father said, this Son goes here. He says, okay, Son, go here. Moon goes over here, Son. I'm going to show you the moon should be over here. Okay, moon goes over here. In other words, Jesus did not have an original thought of his own. The only original thought I can see that Jesus ever had was in the garden. He said, Father, my will is that you take this cup from me. But yet, nevertheless, that's my flesh. That's me saying it, but not me. But not my will be done, but thy will be done. And the Bible says, Jesus said, you know, the Bible said, he said, my meat is to do the will of my Father. So Jesus, his energy, his strength, everything about him was to do the will of his Father. He was such a perfect reflector of his Father. And that's what God wants for you and I. Just wants to say the same thing. Say the same thing, you're going to manifest as the Son of God. How do you manifest? As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. And out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. So when you start speaking the same things that God said, you will become those things. See, look, you become your revelation. I've always said that. Your revelation is your sacrifice. Now, Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice. Abel's sacrifice was a bleeding, dying lamb. What did Abel become? A bleeding, dying lamb. He had a revelation of of being conformed to the image of the firstborn son who was the lamb slain before the foundation of the world, and he became a bleeding, dying lamb. Hallelujah. So, brother and sister, this is the hour that all the sons are supposed to manifest as sons, to be conformed to the image. Okay? Now, Again, Brother Branham said, from seed shall not be heir with the shuck. He said, when he began to brood upon the earth and brought forth marine life, when the Spirit of God, the Logos, the Word, which God said, let there be, and there went the Logos, which is the Word, and the Word began, because all this was in the Logos, the whole Word of God, the whole Bible, but for every age. You hear that? Remember when God breathed into Adam the breath of, what was it called? The breath of what?
Lives,
right. Lives, plural. Not the breath of life. The breath of lives. Because you were breathed into Adam at that point. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And as the Logos begin to breathe upon the earth, there come marine life and building up to bird life and up to animal life. And finally there comes something in the representation or looked like the thing that was brooding over it. God, a man in the very image of God. I know it's a man in the very image of God. Well, what was the image of God at that point? Spirit. And yet he had head, he had hands, he had... I've gone over this many years ago. We went through Godhead. Show you the scripture says God had hands, God had feet, God had eyes, God had ears. He had all these things. Now from attitude and who is God? So he first was God, Jehovah, and out of him... Now let's just picture now as a little drama so you can get it. Let's see, coming out of space... where there's nothing, let's make it a little white light, like a mystic light, like a halo. And that was the Logos that went out of God in the beginning. That was the Son of God that came out of the bosom of the Father. That was what was in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. In the beginning was God, and then out of God came the Logos, a part of God that went out of God. So when it says in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, that's God. That's he's the entire Logos. But then the Word was made flesh. That was the attributes and characteristics that was formed through a spoken word into a son. Now, question answers Hebrews part 2. In the first place, when God, the Logos, that went out of God, or as I went through it, the Catholics call it the eternal sonship of God, which, as I've said before, the word doesn't even make any sense. See, there cannot be an eternal son because a son had to have a beginning. And so Jesus had a beginning. God had no beginning, see? But the son was not eternal sonship, but the son that was with the Father in the beginning was a Logos that went out of God, and it was the theophany of God that went out. The human form that didn't have eyes like you see, but better. A better eye. It didn't have ears like you hear, but a far more hearing. See, it was a theophany that all of this rainbow condescending, oh, this is so beautiful. All this rainbow condescending into a theophany, Moses saw it when it passed through the rock like that. He saw the back part, said it looked like a man. And I get goosebumps when I hear Brother Branham speak of this rainbow essence of God condescending into the form called the theophany that was the Son of God, because that rainbow came in three distinct shapes and forms. And it was a horizontal form, and when the first joined with the second, it made a bowl shape, and when the two joined with the third, it made a complete circle. And the circle speaks of eternity revealed, no beginning, no ending. And that was God that sat over that church while I was preaching there, and God was observing one of his sons, and just think of that. He took time from his busy day running the world, so to speak, to come and watch one of his kids preach about him. And he left over 150 witnesses who saw that. And Brother Branham says, this condescending, this rainbow theophany, it was a theophany that all this rainbow condescended into a theophany. Now remember, a rainbow has seven colors, which is a seven, it's a covenant of God. Each rainbow represents a different color, or each color represents a different promise from God. And each color is also on a spectrogram is seen through a different, there's a different frequency level. And so you're talking about the frequencies of God from red to, I can't remember what the last one is. It's a color of a blue, but anyway. And so you have a broad range of frequency there, and in it was life. All right. And that's what we've been looking at, is this frequency of God going around the world, his word, his Logos. But going round and round and around the world for thousands of years. It strikes a prophet. The prophet speaks And then that word, maybe 700 years, maybe 2,000 years later, it begins to find a people who have that particular gene attribute in them to reflect that word that was spoken. All right? It's gone over the heads of the scholars, gone over the heads of the church ages and all the people throughout the ages because they didn't understand it. But God himself has come down in this hour. He's revealed himself. He's unveiled himself, and we are promised when he shall appear, we shall appear. We shall be like him. We shall appear with him in glory, in the same doxa, the same opinions, same values, the same judgments. Now from Hebrews chapter 1, Brother Branham said, now here's what happened. Oh, excuse me. I just get onto this. This just gets me right here where I love it. See, the Logos and this great fountain of spirit, which had no beginning or no end, this great spirit began to form in the creation, and the Logos that went out from it was the Son of God. It was the only visible form that the spirit had, and it was a theophany, which means a body, and the body was like a man. Moses saw it when it passed through the rock, and he looked at it and said, it looked like the hind part of a man. It's the same type of body that we receive when we die here. Hallelujah. Remember Paul said, if this body of this earth be dissolved, we have another one waiting in the heavens. All right. If this earthly tabernacle be dissolved, we have one already waiting. That was it. And that was a theophany which the Son of God, the Son, that Logos became flesh, became because we were put in flesh. And the theophany, the Logos, became flesh here among us, and it was nothing else but the dwelling place for that entire fountain. Now remember, when you think of fountain, think of that great rainbow. That entire fountain dwelt in him. And think of each promise of God, each attribute, characteristic of God associated in that rainbow, and what each color means in that rainbow. We preached on it several times here. So do you see that? He says, there it is. That was the one. And now the good news is that as he is, so are we in this world. Brother Ram said what you are here is only a reflection of what you are somewhere else. All right. Now from the sermon, Curtain of Time, he said, God, which was a part of God. God seen what the end would be from the beginning. And the Logos come to the earth, which was Christ the Word, spoken Word of God, part of God, and was made flesh and dwelt among us. And then we come out of Christ. You hear that, Gary? We come out of Christ. The anointing. Well, what's the anointing? The Logos. Which makes the same life that was in God, in Christ, in you. No different. The same. And just as sure as God raised this up, we've got to come with the same thing if the same Spirit's in us. And remember, Paul said in Romans 8:11, if the Spirit that raised up Jesus from the dead dwells in you, if the same Spirit that dwelled in Jesus Christ dwells in you, then he will quicken your mortal body. Because it's the Spirit of God making us sons and daughters of God. Isn't that marvelous? How do we get it? By believing on the Lord Jesus Christ, that's what, and accepting it, and then God in heaven, and God in return, gives us the Holy Spirit, crying in our hearts, Abba, Father, my God, and then we are resurrected in the last days to be caught up. He said, in that day you shall know that I'm in the Father in me, I in you, and you in me. So we see that the light that came forth when God spoke the first time was the Logos of God, the theophany of God, which was that part of God which was the Son of God. Not an eternal Son, because we see God speak, and then that light came forth as the Son of God, because all sons have beginnings. Now notice also that this light, that God called it day. And we find this in Peter when he calls it Jesus the day star. He says, we have also a more sure word of prophecy, 2 Peter 1 and 19, whereunto you do well, that you take heed as unto a light that shineth in dark place, unto the day dawn, until the day dawn, and the day star arise in your hearts. And we're also told that Jesus is the light of the world. So I hope the next time you read Genesis 1:1-3, you'll understand how that the world was created, and you will be able to see that the Son of God came forth the first time when God spoke. And God said, now verse 6 now, and God said, let there be firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it divide the waters from the water. And God made the firmament and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament. And it was so. And God called the firmament heaven, and the evening and the morning were the second day. And God said, let the waters under the heaven be gathered together unto one place, and let the dry land appear, and it was so. And God called the dry land earth, and the gathering together of the waters called he seas. And God saw that it was good, and God said, let the earth bring forth grass. Now, we're watching now this development. Let the earth bring forth grass, herb yielding seed, the fruit tree yielding fruit after its kind, whose seed is in itself upon the earth, and it was so. And the earth brought forth grass and herb yielding seed after its kind, and the tree yielding fruit, whose seed was in itself after his kind, and God saw that it was good, and the evening and the morning were the third day. Now notice that God is still speaking and creating and bringing into the earth all the spoken word seeds that will ever be in the earth, but God has not yet clothed the earth with dust, with the elements that make up the earth. We are going to get to that in a short while, so bear with me. But the next thing I want you to notice is that God speaks again, and then the sun, the moon, the stars are all brought forth. And God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the day, and let them be for a sign, for a season, for a day and years, and let them be for lights in the firmament of the heaven to give light upon the earth, and it was so. And God made two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night. He also made the stars. And God set them in the firmament of the heaven to give light upon the earth and to rule over the day and over the night and to divide the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good, and the evening and the morning were the fourth day. So you see, these lights are not the same light that we saw in Genesis 1 and 3. That was the Son of God. And then after he was birthed, God used him as his little helper in the creation of the sun, the moon, the stars, all seed life. So you see, Brother Branham finished up this thought that he spoke on in Question and Answers on Genesis, paragraph 32, where he goes on to say, now in St. John 1, he said, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. God unfolding himself down to a human being. Now watch, how he did it. Now back there then, when this little halo comes, now we can't see nothing yet, but just by eyes, is just supernatural, we see a halo standing there. Now that's the Son of God, the Logos. Now I can see him playing around like a little child before the Father's door and with all eternity. See? And now then in his imaginary makeup, he began to think of what things would be. And I can hear him say, let there be light. And when he did, an atom bursted and the sun came into existence. So God spoke it in the supernatural, in the vision. And then Jesus, the Son of God, pre-incarnate Son of God, spoke it. He said everything God said because he is a spoken word. Therefore, the Son that comes into existence in verse 13, 14 comes much after the birth of the Son in verse 3. Now, let's pick up at verse 20. And God said, let the waters bring forth abundantly the moving creature that hath life and fowl that may fly above the earth in the opening firmament of heaven. And God created great whales and great living creatures that moveth, which the waters brought forth abundantly after their kind, and every winged fowl after his kind. And God saw that it was good. And God blessed them, saying, be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters in the sea, and let fowl multiply in the earth. And the evening and the morning were the fifth day. Now I want you to hold on to your thought here, because we have not yet at this point seen anything manifested. It is still in the form of spoken word, as Peter said, brought out in 2 Peter 3. And God said, now it's all God speaking at this point, let the earth bring forth the living creature after his kind, cattle and creeping things, and the beast of the earth after his kind, and it was so. And God made the beast of the earth after his kind, and the cattle after his kind, their kind, and everything that creepeth upon the earth after his kind, and God saw that it was good. Now God is seen here creating all kinds of life form, from those in the water to those that fly in the air, to those that walk, to those that crawl, to those that slide upon the earth. But none of them to this point is a physical being. They are all to this point in creation still spoken word. Now, when people read this, they think this is all being done instantaneously. These things are done like that. But we're going to find out it isn't so. Because the same one who wrote chapter 1 writes chapter 2. All right? And God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply, and replenish the earth, and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. Now remember, Brother Bram, another quote, I should have put it in here, but I didn't. But Brother Branham says that man was created in God's image. God is spirit. Man was a spirit man. And he said, and man, like the Holy Spirit, moves upon us. He said, man moved upon the creation of God. Now notice, and God said, let us make man in our image. Us and our. After our likeness. And of course, God is spirit. So in his image would have to be spirit man. In the form of spoken word, spirit being. And also notice he said, let us make man in our image after our likeness. And there he was talking to someone who also was in his image, for he said, in our image. Now men have speculated for ages that he was talking to angels, but how could he be talking to angels? Angels are not in the image of God. There was only one at this point who was in the image of God, and that was the Son of God. In the book of Hebrews, the Apostle Paul tells us that it was Jesus Christ who came in the exact image of his Father, who is God. Hebrews 1:1, God, who at sundry time and diverse manners spake in times past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us in Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds. There's your clue. If you go back to Genesis 1 and 3. Who being the brightness, now that word brightness is there specifically, who being the brightness of his glory, now this is rich, the word brightness is translated from the Greek word epagogasma, and exactly means in an off flash. There's Genesis 1, that light. In an off flash of God's glory. God's doxa, his opinions, values, and judgment. Therefore, if he is an off flash, then he had to be that light that flashed forth from God, who is the Logos. And then Paul continues, and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high, being made so much better than the angels, as he hath by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. For unto which of the angels said he at any time, thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee. And again, I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. And again, when he bringeth in the firstborn into the world, he saith, and let the angels of God worship him. Now back to Genesis 1:29. And God said, behold, I have given you every herb bearing seed which is upon the face of the earth, and every tree in the which is the fruit of a tree yielding seed, to you it shall be for meat. And to every beast of the earth, and to every fowl of the air, and to everything that creepeth upon the earth, wherein there is life, I have given every green herb for meat, and it was so. And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good, and the evening and the morning were the sixth day. Now let's continue our reading in Genesis chapter 2, and begin reading in verse 1. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. And on the seventh day God ended his work which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all of his work which he had made. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because in it he had rested from all his work which God created and made. So that seventh day is a time when God has rested from all of his creation. So when you honor the Sabbath day, you're honoring God and his creation. And when you choose to work on a Sabbath, you dishonor God and all he created. Now we know that Jesus is our Sabbath, he is our rest, and we should echo that rest with him by coming to church and worshiping God. These are the generations of the heavens of the earth when they were created in the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens. And every plant of the field before it was in the earth, and every herb of the field before it grew, for the Lord God had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was not a man to till the ground. There's your answer right there. Before it was even in the earth, it was in God. And then God placed it by a spoken word into the earth, and it has sat there, you and I sat there in a gene seed in this earth for thousands of years we were in his mind before the foundation of the world, but when he planted all the seeds that ever will be, we were planted here as well. So did you catch what he said? He was talking about the lineages and the generations of the seed before God placed that seed in the earth and before it even grew. God placed it all as seed life in spirit form in the earth before it ever became a living entity filled with the elements and dust of the earth. And this is all before God even made a way to water the seeds. The life was planted in the earth by the spoken word. Therefore, it is Logos seed form. But there was not yet any way to water it to make it come forth. So God brings forth a mist from the earth to water it. And there went up a mist from the earth and watered the whole face of the ground. Now notice in verse 7 we see that God now puts dust to his creation. And the Lord God formed man in the dust of the earth and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and that should actually be lives. And man became a living soul. I mean, the Hebrew actually says lives, not life. Now, many people look at this, and without understanding, they think, why is there another creation? But this does not say God created man. It says God formed man. Remember in Genesis 1, he created man. Now he formed man. God took dust and clothed the man with a physical body. And the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there he put the man whom he had formed. And out of the ground made the Lord God to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food, the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Out of the ground. Well, you know, if there's no seed in the ground, then nothing's going to come up. The seed was there in the ground. All right? So I hope you see that Brother Branham, what he's saying from a man that can turn on the light, he said, now the seed was already upon the earth. I believe God had planted the seed, and just as long as the sun could get to that seed, it began to grow. And that's the reason it only taken days to bring forth these things, because the seed was already in the earth. All it needed was light. And now he can. Now let's continue with what Brother Brown says. And that's the way God has today. So we've given you 3/4 of the message this morning just to get you to this point. It's the same thing today. The seed of God is in the earth. All right. His seed is already here, his word. The only thing it needs is light on it. And he is that light, for he is the word. The word and the light is the same thing. The life in there is the light of the word. See, is the life. The germ of life lays within the grain, and the grain is the life is what breaks forth and brings forth the life out of the grain. That's the way that Christ in the word makes the word do what it is supposed to do. Now remember, the scripture plainly teaches us that it is God which worketh in us both to will and to do his good pleasure. Brother Brown continues, light brings life. Plant the weed out there, you put it in the basement, cover it all over, it'll never bring forth anything because it can't. There's no light there. But as soon as light strikes it, then it'll bring forth life if it's a germinated seed. That's the same thing it is in the word. See, the word is God. And when the light strikes it, it brings the word to life again. Every age has always been that. That's why when you're getting pulled under the water, under the log, and your heart went up to God, what happened? Light brings life. You see that? So that word, God the Logos, the light, has been circling the earth for ages, and the seed life is already planted in the earth, you and me. These bodies that we live in are just a combination of carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, phosphorus, sulfur, etc. But within that form was a predestinated seed. And all those elements just attached itself to when we were born to bring us into a three dimensions where we live. But God's word, as long as it just stayed in that higher dimension, it remained in seed form. But as we were born to this earth first, we did not know the higher calling as sons and daughters of God. But when we are born of his spirit, we were quickened with his life, and it is his spirit that has anointed that seed of God, that has laid dormant in our vessel to anoint us to that word, that has been circling the earth, that ordained sons and daughters to adoption, to manifestation of sons, to the place of being conformed to the image of the firstborn son. Now, I'd just like to stop here and just say this. Now you say, well, just a minute now. You know, every person on earth has a certain shape, certain features. And, you know, I can look back and I say, well, I got this from my mom and I got this from my dad. And, you know, honestly, I can look back and see my grandpa had this and my grandma had this over here. And you can say, look at the features that you have. And I was talking back in 1975 with Brother Vail, we're talking about predestination election. And he said, I believe at the white throne, God can take us and show us our lineage, how it had to come through our parents or grandparents all the way back to Adam and Eve, or all the way back to Satan, to the serpent and Eve. Now, Brother Brian made the comment. He said, you think that the virgin birth was something. He said, the natural birth is far a greater thing than the virgin birth. Because God knew exactly what you would look like before the foundation of the world, and had to make sure you got the right combination of DNA. So he had to make sure that your parents got together. That's why some people that are born out of wedlock, you know, out of wedlock is not the same thing as a bastard-born child. A bastard-born child is when two married people switch over and the husband of one gets together with the wife of another and they bring forth a child. That's a bastard-born. Child born out of wedlock is not the unpardonable sin. Brother Branham said so. I've got quotes for it. Now, the child's going to suffer its whole life because of your act. But the thing is, it's not an unforgivable thing, and it won't keep you out of the other side. All right. But the fact is that we go back to predestination. Sometimes a person makes a mistake, and all I can say is, well, maybe God saw that child before the foundation of the world had to look a certain way. And he allowed the woman to make her mistakes to bring it. I'm not justifying it. I'm just saying that in the plan of God, you know, you reap what you sow. All right. But but as we were born of this earth first, we did not know the higher calling of sons and daughters of God, but when we were born of his spirit, we were quickened with his life. And it is his life that has anointed that seed of God that has laid dormant in our vessel, that gene seed, to anoint us to that word that has been circling the earth, that ordains sons and daughters to adoption, that ordains sons and daughters to manifestation of sons, that ordains sons and daughters to the place of being conformed to the image of the firstborn son. That word was spoken by the Apostle Paul 2,000 years ago. But I believe it's for a people today. All right. For when God's great parousia presence came down and the light of his glorious presence struck your gene seed, like the crystal strikes the frequency traveling in the fourth dimension, it brings us into manifestation. And when that takes place, that word becomes our clothing, and we are clothed by that word. Remember, when word is piled upon word, it'll take a hold of every fiber of your body. That's what Brother Brown said. Or that word becomes reflected through our gene seed, just as a crystal projects a frequency onto the television screen. So too, God's word becomes projected into our flesh and God's life. His life. Remember, he's invisible. But that life becomes projected into what? This. You've got to have a screen for people to see it. Your body's your screen. And that word that was spoken before the foundation of the world, that he said would have children ready for adoption at the end time, that word is still circling. And as we listen to it day and night, day and night, day and night, we get a glimpse of that life through the portal of the tapes. When the Spirit strikes that word, it becomes manifested. That is why I say we need to constantly be in those tapes. That is our portal, my brother and sister, into the presence of God. Because we know that was God's voice for this generation. We see that the manifesting of himself to us brings revelation to us of himself. For God interprets his own word by bringing it to pass. But even more importantly than that is the fact that we have this great promise that when he shall manifest in his true character, so shall we manifest in our true character. That's why I believe that if the word of God is being truly presented in an open and unhindered manner, you cannot hide if you try it. And when that word is presented in such a way, you will manifest who you are, and he will make known the counsel of your heart. And you will not escape it, for as surely as light makes manifest in the natural what life is in the seed, so too the light of the glorious presence coming forth from a vessel that is perfectly reflecting that light, it will most assuredly cause all that sit under that ministry to become exposed, exposed as to just what they are. And those who do not like what they see in themselves will not stay around to receive more exposing of themselves. That is why the Apostle John wrote in 3:19, and this is the condemnation, that light, logos, is come into the world. And men love darkness rather than, or in a greater way than they love light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone that doeth evil hates the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his own deeds should be reproved. But he that doeth truth cometh to the light, that his deeds may be made manifest, that they are wrought in God. Now, for the rest of this morning, I want to look at how God brings a light into our life to bring forth a projection of his life in us. From the Patmos vision, Brother Branham said, and a true minister of God don't reflect some flashlight, some match stem, some shuck a burning. He reflects the golden rays of Christ to the church. That he's the same and he's alive and he shines on me. Amen. That's the light he reflects. The star reflects the light of the sun. See? So we're reflecting the light of the Son of God, doing the same thing he did. That's John 14:12. Giving light. And from his sermon, Patmos Vision, Brother Branham said, Christ is alive, he's in us. Not some nail or piece of cloth or piece of bone or something. He's the living God living in us now, manifesting himself. We only have one article of memorial. That's the Lord's Supper, commemoration of his death. But as far as Christ himself, he is with us and in us. And that's the thing that we want to wave, the glory of the Holy Spirit to the world. Wave it until the light goes out. All right? The ministers that kept and brought the light and held it back like the original at the beginning and brought the light through. And remember, the seven stars was in his hand, right hand. Just think, we were drawing their current from their light, from him. They were completely under his control, in his hand. Oh, every true servant of God is the same way. In Revelation 21:23, if you want to put it down in the New Jerusalem, 21:23, he is the Lamb that's in the city, that's the light thereof, shining. For they needed no light in the city, the sun shall not rise in it, because the Lamb which is in the midst of the city shall be the light thereof. And the nations that's saved shall walk in the light of the Lamb. Amen. He is the Lamb's light. Now, would you like to have his life living in you, reflecting his presence? Christ standing in the midst of the people, them seven golden candlesticks reflecting his radiance like the sun in the middle of its heat. Now, I don't believe that Brother Branham is asking this question just so that he can say, well, see, I'm that one. He asked the question because he genuinely believed it for every son, every daughter of God, to reflect that light of God's presence in our life. Brother Branham said, we, the church, needs to lay in the presence of the Son to ripen. And how can a fivefold minister reflect this light so perfectly? He can only do this as he aligns himself to the light coming forth from the prophet of his age. For God truly shall do nothing unless he reveals it first, and then through the prophets. Now, from the church age book, and then in closing, and I actually had seven more pages today, but I decided to put that off till next week. Brother Branham tells us, he said, in every age we have exactly the same pattern. That is why the light comes through some God-given messenger in a certain area, and then from that messenger there spreads the light through the ministry of others who have been faithfully taught. And as Brother Vail said, to be faithfully taught takes two things. One who is faithful to teach, and others who are just faithful to shut up and listen. But the problem is that not everyone who hears the prophet's echoes what he said. Many take what they want and let go of that which they don't want, but they refuse to say all that was said and how he said it. Therefore, they are not truly reflecting what was said. Why would they do that? Why would they come to the light and then reject it? All I can say is just look at today. You have stealth. What does stealth do? It reflects it in different directions so that you can't tell it's there. All right? And Brother Branham goes on to say, but of course, all those who go out don't always learn how necessary it is to speak only what the messenger has spoken. Now remember, Paul warned the people to say only what he said. 1 Corinthians 14:37. If any man think himself to be a prophet or spiritual, let him acknowledge that the things that I write unto you are the commandments of the Lord. What? Came the word of God out from you, or came it unto you only? They add here, they take away there. And soon the message is no longer pure, and the revival dies down. How careful we must be to hear one voice. For the Spirit has but one voice, which is the voice of God. Paul warned them to say what he said. See, people want to say that one voice is Brother Branham. No, Brother Branham was just a vessel. There's one voice. Paul had the same voice. And any true servant of God has the same voice if he has the same word. Paul warned them to say what he said, even as Peter did, likewise. Well, if you got Peter is a voice and Paul's a voice, isn't that two voices? But he said one voice. Because Peter didn't say what Peter thought. Peter said what God thought. Well, then whose voice is it? God's voice. Paul said the same thing. Paul said, if any man think himself to be spiritual, acknowledge one thing. The words that I come to you are the words of God. He warned them that even he, Paul, could not change one word of what he had given by revelation. Oh, how important it is to hear the voice of God by way of his messenger and then say. See, that's what they're leaving out today. They're saying how important it is to hear the voice of God by way of his messenger, But Brother Branham doesn't just end there. He says, and then say what has been given them to say to the churches. See, because if you're not reflecting it, you don't got it. I'm sorry, but you're not aligned up. You're not aligned with the prophet. You're not aligned with the light if you're not saying it. Because the reflection stops there. No reflection. If you ever stood in one of those mirrors that they kind of fold, you know, the mirror here, you try on a suit or something like that, try folding them in to where you can see about 28. That's about the most I've ever been able to count, is 28 different me's in the mirror. But you, if you get it so perfect, you can see into infinity, or eternity, we'll call it. So you get that lined up, that your thoughts lined up perfectly with God's thoughts, you are now in eternity. All right? I think we're just going to leave off here and continue next Sunday. Now remember, we also have communion service next Sunday evening, as well as at 5 p.m. So let's just spend our time this week getting ready. And let's begin our getting ready for next week by bowing our heads right now. Gracious Father, we want to thank you, Lord, for your word. We know, Father, that many of us understood these things already, but Father, it's just good to go over them and to show, Father, that this circling of the earth, the Logos, that went forth before the foundations of the earth has been circling and circling and circling and circling. And every once in a while, a prophet would catch a glimpse of something and he'd speak it out of his mouth. And then down the road, like Isaiah spoke, and then 700 and some years later, they asked John, "Are you the Christ?" He said, "Nope." "Are you that Messiah?" "Nope." Are you that prophet to come?" "Nope." Well, who are you?" He said, I'm the voice of one who is crying in the wilderness, make straight the paths and make ready and prepare ourselves for the coming of the Lord." So we see John recognize that gene seed in John recognized that was him. So my question this morning is, Father, do we truly recognize that when the scripture speaks of sons and daughters to be adopted, do we claim it? Do we believe that that is for us? When you said that your sons and daughters shall manifest as sons and daughters, do we really believe that that's for us? When your word says that we will be conformed to the very image of the firstborn son, does that speak to our heart? Does that resonate? Hallelujah. Does it resonate? Does it echo within us until it becomes projected into our flesh from our gene seed? Because what we are here is only a reflection of what we are somewhere else. Hallelujah. So Father, I just pray that we'd not only be preparing for next Sunday for communion service, but Lord, that we'd be preparing our souls for the going home, and before that, Lord, for the resurrection ministry, when we know that things that have been left undone will be finished up. Help us, Father, to bask in thy presence. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Let's sing that song, Within the Veil. I think it's number, 22 or 204? Let's see, what is it? Which number is it? 204 in the Behold book, okay. Within the veil I now have come.